the things that they discuss with the policymakers as well as the academicians and all concerned, whether the economies should be fiscally stimulated or we have to have austerity measures. At the moment, it seems that the authorities has opted for, in order to put the things right, by introducing policies of austerity measures. When we look at our own experience back in 2001 and afterwards, of course, Turkey opted for, in order to put its own house in order for fiscal austerity. But the one difference that exists then and today is that at that time Turkey was ill, but the rest of the world was healthy. Therefore, almost everyone is ill. Therefore, there are some merits in those discussions that the fiscal stimulus may help in some circumstances. But in our case, it was the fiscal austerity that saved us from the problems that we faced at that time. So what I am going to do in the remaining time of the seminar is that I will present first what was the Turkish economy before 2001, and then I will briefly describe the, in a brief summary of what we did in 2001 and that the reforms afterwards and what we are now at the moment. If I may put in a nutshell, what may characterize the Turkish economy before 2001 was that it was a fiscal indiscipline that caused the problem. It was, in a nutshell, it's a fiscal indiscipline. We went stretching our legs, not according to our blanket, I would say. It was spending more than what it is collected in taxes and in revenues. Basically, it was the public sector disorder that caused the problems in Turkey. If you look at, what was the picture exactly before the 2001 and the events that leading to the crisis was that, as you see in the graph, the public sector borrowing requirement was too high. In 1999, it was close to 13%. Why this has happened is because that there was a provision in the central bank law saying that if any government wanted to spend, let's say, 100 unit in fiscal year, they had the legal access to the central bank resources for the 15%. So 15% they could borrow from the central bank. Usually what used to happen was that sometimes, especially during the coalition governments, the budget that was put forward at the beginning of the year where used to be, all the appropriate used to be spent at the end of the third term, the government used to bring in another substantial budget. And another 15% of this extra budget used to be taken from the central bank. And therefore, it was, as I said before, it was the fiscal indiscipline that caused the Turkish problem. This is can be seen in the public sector borrowing requirement as well as the share of the interest payments in the budget. It was an area of 35 years stemming from early 1970s to 2001. Turkey lived in a high but ironically stable inflation environment. Average inflation was about 70%. Interest rates was very high, but it did not go into a hyperinflation. Had it gone into a hyperinflation, probably we would have done things better than that. But 35 years, 40 years, we lived in a high but stable inflation environment of around 70-75%. Again, when we look at the fiscal conditions in terms of numbers and percentages, public sector borrowing requirement to GDP, interest payments as a share of the GDP, domestic debt to GDP, and the foreign debt to GDP. all along the year from 1975 to 1990, things were worsening because of this fiscal indiscipline. Well, as I said, what lied behind this deterioration in the fiscal balance of the country was because of the utilization of the central bank resources. As you see from the graph, at one point, the central bank financing as percentage of the budget went up to 2% of the GDP. From, we had a small banking crisis financially in 1994. It was a homemade, a self-made, because towards end of the 1993, the government then did not extend the maturing debt. They had the auctions, but because of the, they considered the interest rates was too high, which was around 70 to 75%, 8 maturing debt were paid to the market, but government did not borrow from the market. Therefore, system was with excess liquidity, and there was, because of there was a fixed exchange rate regime, the banks and the people with the excess liquidity went to the market and bought the foreign exchange, and the central bank reserves come down. And then we went into the financial crisis of 1994. And after that, there was a change in the central bank. Now, gradually, the 15% short-term advance from the central bank to the central government were reduced from 15% to 3% by the end of 1998, but it was not enough to eliminate the crisis that was ended up in 2001. Again, this was led to the crowding out. There was no resources left to the private sector to invest, to increase economic activity. It was mainly an economy between government and the banks. Banks were collecting deposit from the public, the lending to the government, and the government paying back. If you look at the credit development, at that time, of course, the indebtedness of the Turkish households were very low, but it was the indebtedness of the public sector that caused the problem. The consumer credit went up towards the end of 1999 because from the beginning of the 2000, we had a what's called the exchange rate based stabilization program with the IMF. We pre-announced the likely pass of the basket of dollars and the euro then, and this was followed for 1.5 years, and afterwards when we reached the target reducing the inflation and the interest rate, then the gradually Turkish currency would be left to floating. But before reaching end of the program collapsed at the October 2000 and also led to February 2001 crisis, which was the full-fledged banking crisis. Again, low financial deepening. Total financial assets of the GDP was very low, but towards end of the period, it increased. Again, banking sector. Banking sector was very weak because the open foreign FX position, foreign exchange position of the banks were very high. Their assets compared to the liabilities was very high. Therefore, it was open to currency attack. This was what happened in 2001. As I said, because of these developments, system finance itself from the government finance itself from the central bank resources, and also because of this high open FX position, as well as the high interest rates and the inflation, caused the banks to have a large open position. They usually had the access to the central bank. In effect, central bank financing the banks in an unlimited amount. And therefore, as you see from the light and graph, daily open market operation interest rates was in 2000 was very high. This was the end of exchange rate based stabilization program, but afterwards, because of the measures taken, it came down. Average borrowing cost of the Treasury. As you see in the graph, at one point in 1994, it went up 160%. Therefore, what was the government was borrowing from the market was not sufficient to pay the interest burden. And therefore, it was an economy borrowing from the public and collecting the revenue and paying back to the those who lent the central government. As I said, this is an economy where the fiscal discipline was flying very high. Again, same graph in numbers. You see the interest rate, both coefficient of variation as well as the mean and also the exchange rate developments. The inflation rate, as I said, at one point it went up to the three-digit numbers. And because of this high inflation environment, people, businessmen didn't know how to plan, how to act, how to invest. And therefore, growth rate was very erratic. We had a positive 5%, 6% growth 1 year, minus same amount next year. Under these circumstances, of course, the economy became very volatile. And therefore, neither the consumers nor the businessmen were able to see their future and behave accordingly. Again, the same graph with the numbers, inflation and the GDP growth. Of course, under these circumstances, the current account deficit was always posed a problem in Turkey's history. It is only in those periods or years that the Turkey had a negative growth, Turkey has had a positive current account surplus. It is still the same problem today. There is a trade-off between Turkey's current account deficit and the growth rate. If Turkey wants to grow faster and higher, we have to have higher current account deficit. It is because that the dependency of the Turkish export as well as the Turkish industrial production on the imported content of the economic activity is too high. So all these developments led to a crisis in 2001. And before that, this IMF supported stabilization program, of course, as I said, at the end of 1999, we had an exchange rate based stabilization program. The objective of the program was, of course, fighting the chronic inflation, stabilizing the economy, controlling the public debt. And through what means we were going to do it was through pre-announced crawl and peg system, monetary and fiscal discipline, and structural reforms. But because of the huge FX position in the banking system and the long delayed measures in terms of the structural problems and also unsustainable current account deficit resulted in the full-fledged crisis in the 2001. And this is the end result of the crisis. As you see, Turkey's risk premium went up, Turkish currency depreciated. Then Turkey has come to the end of what can be done by fiscal expansion. We have to put our house in order, and therefore we had a full-fledged banking crisis in 2001. With that crisis, of course, we initiated a reform program. At that time, there was three anchors for the Turkish economy. One was the EU accession and the EU standards, and the other one was the IMF program with the standby agreements, and of course, the Turkish own internal dynamics. With the new policy after the crisis, in first of all, structural reforms has to be enacted. In this respect, public sector reform, financial sector reform, and on enhancing the role of the private sector. These were the aims of the three standby agreement that Turkey signed with the IMF. And the fiscal policy aimed at primary surplus of 6.5% on a yearly basis, which was very difficult to achieve, and building credibility, improving debt composition, and on the monetary policy side, of central bank became independent. The law was amended in April 2001, and the central bank, given the task of the mandate of bringing down inflation and price stability, as well as the financial stability. Therefore, out of these reforms that the standby agreement with the IMF initiated, we aimed at single-digit inflation, debt reduction, and achieved the sustainable growth. In terms of banking restructuring, we had what is called the transition to the strong economy in May 2001. At that time, of course, the banking system was, as I said, very weak. Therefore, we had to close down about more than 20 banks. We set up a what is called the bad bank and taken all the assets of these failing banks into this bad bank, and we managed their assets from through that bank. And also, until 2001, in Turkey, banking regulation and supervision was in the hand of Turkish Treasury. And with this program, with the IMF, on the IMF initiative, we, in a sense, emulated the UK system. We separated the central bank functions and the banking regulation supervision, and we set up an independent body, and we authorized this licensing and all that. And with those set up, the deposit insurance fund was the responsible for the sorting out the failing banks. They overtaken the assets of the bad assets of these banks, and they resold it and tried to recoup the money that they spent from the owners of the banks. And the banking law was changed, and at the moment in Turkey, bank owners and the general managers is responsible unto the third degree of their relatives if any credit is lost because of their credit examination and all that. In terms of monetary policy, as I said, the central bank's primary objective was the price stability, and the central bank became independent in April 2001, and the central bank aim at first, it increased its operational capacity, analyzing the incoming data and putting a meaning on it and acting accordingly. And therefore, for a certain period of up until 2006, what we called was not open inflation targeting, but we prepared ourselves for open inflation targeting until 2006. Therefore, not only the inflation, the price stability, but also the financial stability become very important, because if you don't have financial stability, then price stability does not mean much. And this is the on a time scale, what we did from 1989 to 2012. So with these policies implemented, what was the outcome? What is the outcome where we are at the moment? As you see from the graph, the public sector borrowing requirements percentage to the GDP has considerably come down, and therefore public sector has made huge savings because of the primary surplus that was initiated by the IMF program. 6% of the GDP, 6% of the GDP every year we have to aim. And of course, we have not been able to achieve the 6% primary surplus, but it was on average for the year from 2001 to 2010, it was about 5.7%. As you see, primary, the development of the primary surplus. And also, at the time, before the crisis, government were borrowing on a short term, and the percentages of the domestic issued debt instruments, as well as the foreign currency denominated debts, were not evenly distributed. Because of the high interest rate, government were borrowing from abroad if markets allowed it, and therefore the share of the domestic foreign currency in the domestic borrowing was high, as you see on the right-hand graph. Also, the maturity was about 65 days, no more than 2 months, but from 2002 up until today, I think the maturity of the Turkish average debt stock has increased to around 16 months. Average cost of borrowing has come down. Because of the lower interest payments, government has a fiscal rule, fiscal room, in order to do things that it was not able to do before. Public debt stock, it was in 2002, it was 74% to the GDP. It is now around less than 40%, probably our fourth quarter GDP rate. The growth rate has not been announced yet. It will be announced at the end of this month. Therefore, we are expecting the 2012 debt-to-GDP ratio around 36.5%. And we, with the medium-term program, we are aiming at 31% GDP, debt-to-GDP ratio by the end of 2015. Again, under the fixed exchange rate regime, of course, the foreign exchange risk was on the public sector. When there is a run on the currency, government has to supply the needed foreign exchange, provided that the reserve levels are allowed it to give the all the required demand, to meet the required demand. But after the crisis, Turkey left the fixed exchange regime. Now we are full-fledged floating exchange regime. Under this regime, of course, the exchange rate risk is on the market. And therefore, the composition of the central government debt has changed, and the domestic debt, because of the contained inflation and the lower interest rates, enable the government to borrow more from the domestic market rather than from international markets. Therefore, the composition changed in favor of domestic currency. Again, inflation rate, as I said, it was at one point in 1994, went up to three-digit numbers. And from 1983 to 1994, average was 62%. 95 to 2000, 71%, 2002 and 2011, it is 11.2%. And the latest figures is around 6.32%. And government and the central bank together announces 3-year inflation target. And the targets, as you see in the graph, 5.3% to this year, and 5% and 5% 14 and 2011. 15. Because of the inflation has been contained and was under control, accordingly, interest rate has come down. At the moment, central bank's policy rate is below 5%, and the at the market, but policy rate is 5.25%. The interest rate on the two-year government bond is around 6% at the moment. Benchmark interest rate. Of course, with this macroeconomic stability, lower inflation, lower interest rates, elimination of foreign exchange risk and all that has led to bring a situation where the economic agents were able to see their future in a better way, and therefore improvement in the economic activity led to a higher rate growth rate. And average growth rate, as you see from the 2002 up until the crisis, the international crisis, the Lehman Brothers and all that in 2008, 7.2%. And it has come down since then, 2.5%. And medium-term program at the moment aims at 4% growth this year and the 5% the year after. This, of course, this situation has had improvement in the GDP per capita, and it was 3.4 thousand at the end of 2002. It is now around 13,000. Of course, this situation has led to an improvement in the employment conditions, but in Turkey there is an argument that some people claim that all of these developments did not create an employment, because this growth was without any employment. I think this is not correct. Turkey has created about 4,000 jobs after 2007, 4 million jobs, but because of the improvement in the economic conditions, labor force participation has also increased. Labor force participation rate was around 45%. It is now over 50%, and mainly the extra participation is coming from the female section of the working force. As for the income distribution, the equity purposes, there is a slight improvement in terms of Gini coefficient. This means that the distribution of income is getting better. But there are pockets of sections in the society who are underprivileged. Therefore, this does not explain everything in the economy. But in order to make international comparisons, we have to give this to international audience so that where the Turkish equity, that is income distribution, where was it and where has it come to? Of course, this reduction in the debt level and also the government's borrowing from the market has enabled the private sector to have more of the resources, and therefore the main source of the Turkish growth has been due to the private sector. It is not the government sector. It is the private sector-led growth, and also because the resources, more resources left to the private sector because of the reduced inflation, reduced interest rates, and the less borrowing requirement by the government. Of course, this situation has led to a situation where the credit expansion has increased. One of the things that the problems that the Turkey is facing now is overheating of the economy. Why this has happened is because that, first of all, the indebtedness of the Turkish households is very low. It is around, at the beginning of 2006 and 7, it was around 6% of the GDP. It is now 18% of the GDP. This number, as you know, in the East European countries around 33-35%, in Europe is 60-65%, in the United States even higher. And the second element is the interest rate, because of the control of inflation, has come down from around 16.75 to what it is now, less than 5%. And therefore, it enabled, because of the low indebtedness, low interest rates, and the high capital adequacy ratio of the banking system. Average banking capital adequacy ratio in Turkey, as defined by the BIS and the Banking Committee, is around 18% at the moment. And the Turkish authorities does not allow the banks to go below 12%. The legal rate, as you know, is 8%. They have the right to go less below the 12%, but if they go, they are not fine. But if they come to the authorities to open a branch, authorities does not allow them to open the branch. Therefore, the minimum floor for the banking system's capital adequacy ratio is 12%, but actual number is close to 18%. At one time, it went over 20%. Therefore, these three elements, the low indebtedness, low interest rates, and the ability of the banking system to extend the credit, has caused Turkish economy, the growth of the credit. And this credit has heated up the economy, and therefore it created some concerns for the financial stability. And at one point last year, the current account deficit was close to 10% of the GDP. Of course, this created a concern for financial stability and the crisis, and therefore authorities enacted a policy whereby they've been able to reduce the current account deficit from around 10% of the GDP to 6.5% at the moment. Of course, this was done at the cost of lower growth rate. Therefore, problem that Turkey is facing at the moment is a trade-off between sustainable current account and the higher growth rate. If Turkey wants to have higher growth rate, as we had in 2010 and 11, which was 9.2% in 2010, 8.5% in 2011, but the current account went up to 10%. Therefore, there is a strong trade-off between current account deficit as well as the growth rate. Therefore, we have to find an appropriate level where we can have the growth rate, which is closer or above the potential growth rate of the economy, and a current account deficit which does not create a crisis environment. This is the problem that Turkey is facing at the moment for policymakers. As I said, the NPLs and the capital adequacy ratios in the graph, which I already said. Of course, one of the things that Turkey suffered during the high inflationary and high interest rate environment, dollarization, because the people lost confidence in the domestic currency. If you put 100 liras in the pocket of your citizens at the beginning of the year, and because of the 70-80% inflation at the end of the year, purchasing power of this 100 lira comes to 30 liras, no one will accept, use your own currency. And therefore, Turkish economy highly dollarized before the crisis. At one point, it went, the deposit in the banking system went up to 65-66%. It is still, as you see in the graph, there are still important level of dollarization in the economy. This is because if the society lives 35-40 years in a high inflation environment, it is not easy to erase the old memories from the mind of the people. And still people, in terms of both liability dollarization as well as the asset dollarizations, there's a dollarization in the Turkish economy. In terms of asset dollarization, it is mainly the households who keep some of their savings in the banking system. But in terms of liability dollarization, it is the private sector who borrows from abroad. Therefore, one of the things that Turkey has to watch in the future, this dollarization by the private sector. At the moment, total debt of the private sector is $230 billion. So any movement in the fixed rate may adversely affect them. As you see, the current account deficit, the history from 2001 to, and also projections into the 2015, it was close to 10% in 2011, 9.7%. It is now gradually coming down, but of course at the cost of lower economic growth. Why Turkey experiencing high current account deficit is because of the import content dependency of the Turkish manufacturing industry. At one point, there was a number circulating in the system that in order to manufacture one unit of goods, I think the manufacturer has to import no less than 0.80% imported goods. Therefore, this high dependency on the imported intermediate goods as well as the raw materials causes the Turkish current account deficit. But the bulk of it is energy consumption, energy import. Therefore, if we look at the current account deficit trade balance, including energy and excluding energy, of course, picture improves a lot without the energy. But Turkey has to import this. Therefore, there are many energy saving measures that is Turkish economy and the policymakers has to undertake in the future to come. Again, 12-month cumulative billion US dollar current account deficit with total current account as well as the without current account without energy. In the past, the main trading partner of Turkey used to be, it is still the same, the European Union. In 2008, 56% of the Turkish export went to the European markets and the bulk of it to the EU zone. But with the start of the problems and the collapse of the Lehman Brothers and all that, at the moment, our export to European markets is less than 40%. But we have been able to diversify our export markets as well as the goods that we export. And therefore, one of the positive impacts of this crisis, that the pressure that it put on Turkey is to diversify its export markets from the north of Caucasian, Georgia, Azerbaijan, through the eastern part of the country to the North Africa, Gulf countries, and as well as any part of the world. And therefore, this is one of the benefits of the crisis that the Turkey has caught. Of course, international reserves is very important, and the Turkish international reserves, because of the inflow of foreign currency, because of the improved conditions at home, which causes sometimes problem because of its excess supply of foreign currency leading to appreciation of the currency. It is a problem, and Turkey has to take it in consideration. It is one of the pillars that the Turkey policy makers has to take this into consideration. But the positive side of this enable Turkey to build up its reserves, as you see in the graph. Sorry. This is the risk premium of Turkey in the international markets. At the time, credit default swaps were above 1,000 for a number of European countries. Turkey's credit default swaps was around 280, 290. And it is still the same as you see in the graph. Exchange rate is stabilized. Volatility has become less and less. And the credit rating. Because of these developments, the credit agency, one of the credit agencies, has upgraded Turkey's. At the moment, it is BBB minus, and we are expecting other rating agencies to do the same, but they have some reservations. It is because of this fact that the dollarization of the private sector is a little bit higher. This has it put some hesitation on the some of the rating agencies. All of these developments, of course, has led to improvement in the Turkish competitiveness in international context. As you see in the graph, it is a much better position at the moment. Of course, where we go from here? Of course, all of this economic activity is to improve the living conditions of these people at large and bring about a sustainable growth and so that the per capita income increases. And in terms of our accession and the relation to the European average income, of course, we are has made great improvement in terms of growth rate itself. But if you compare this to the per capita income increase in other countries, the relative position of the Turkey has improved. It is, as you see in the graph, it was about 35% of the at the beginning of 2003. It is now about 57%. Of course, there are a long way to go in order to catch up the 100% average GDP per capita income in the Eurozone. Of course, these measures that taken and the improvements in the public management of the economy has brought about a situation where public debt levels has become less and less and manageable, well below the Maastricht criteria. Of course, there are things that should be done in order to catch up this income gap, in order to close the income gap. Turkish authorities has put forward, not it is a plan structured and the programmed measures, but have idealized a situation at the 100 years of Turkish Republic in 2023, where the aim is to have an economy of $2 trillion, which will bring the Turkey to 10th largest economy in the world, and to have a trade volume more than $1 trillion, of which around more than $500 billion will be Turkish exports, and to have per capita income around 25%, $25,000, and bring down the unemployment rate from the current level of around 9.2% to 5.5%. Can it be achieved? Of course, it is difficult. In order to have a $2 trillion economy from now to until 2023, which is about 11 years, we have to grow no less than 5% to 5% without any interruption. In order to do it, I think the Turkey has to invest at least 25% of its GDP as an investment. But in order to make a 25% of the GDP as an investment, you have to have a financing of it. How are you going to finance it? By savings. The savings are very low in Turkey at the moment because of the young generation. They are spending more rather than saving. Because of this demographic structure, at the moment, saving ratio to the GDP is around 12 to 14%. Therefore, the gap between the investment that Turkey has made and the financing requirement is rather large, and it gives a current account deficit. Therefore, these are the measures in order to close the gap between investment and the savings and through structural changes. These structural changes, of course, Turkish authorities are working hard on it. Basically, I think we have to, the number one in this respect is the education and the making the Turkish working population more skillful than ever before, increase the productivity. In the past, because of this religious education controversy and all that, I think the vocational education suffered a lot in Turkey. I think this should be overcome, and the government has initiated a new educational program, making the education compulsory for 12 years. It is now 8 years. But what will the result? It is an open question and the hotly being debated at the moment. And with these things, I end my presentation. If there is any questions, I am ready to answer.